at this place in my life, I can truly tell you that my focus is ahead, not behind. There is nothing back there for me to go back to or to look back to. I can tell you truly in my heart, I have rounded third and I'm headed home. And we're going to talk about that today, looking for city. You can look in your bulletin for the references, Hebrews. And we're going to spend our time in Philippians chapter 3. But if you find, first of all, Hebrews 11, verses 8 through 10 and 13, chapter 13, verse 14, here you'll see that Abraham was looking for a city. He lived in the Ur of the Chaldees, but God said, get up and go and find a new home. And Abraham was one that was looking for a city. Back where I came from when I was a little boy, they had what was commonly called sangins. Have you ever been to a sangin? Oh my. The country folks would gather in the little churches or in a living room. Miss Goldie Harbor could play that piano better than Jerry Lee Lewis. And they would sing and they would rock and roll and they would sing. I remember Drusilla Harrison was an girl, she couldn't make it ring. There's a song in the paperback hymn books, and you've heard Vesta Goodman sing it a lot. Looking for a city where we shall never die, where we shall never say goodbye. There we'll meet our Savior and our loved ones too. Come, O Holy Spirit, all our hopes renew. I can hear that song ringing in my ears now in those little sangins that they had back in the days long gone by. But today we want to think about where we're going in our journey from here to there, from now to then, and how to get there. We're somebody going somewhere and we're on our way. And when we come to the book of Philippians chapter 3, we're going to see the roadmap. But first of all, just for a text and a reminder, look at Hebrews and look at chapter 11. In Hebrews chapter 11, verses 8 and 10, this was the journey of Abraham when God called him to become the father of the Jewish nation. Chapter 11, verse 10. For he looked for a city which had foundations, whose building and maker is God. Through faith also Sarah herself received strength to conceive seed and was delivered of a child when she was past age, because she judged him faithful who had promised. You and I have a promise, and it's in John 14, 1 through 3. Jesus said, I go to prepare a place for you. If I go and prepare a place for you, I'll come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, you can be also. In chapter 14, or rather in chapter 13, verse 14, chapter 13, verse 14. For here we have no continuing city, but we seek one to come. Paul said, I live in this tabernacle of the body, flesh, and bone. He said, one of these days I'm going to lay that tabernacle, that city aside, and I'm going to enter in to a new place of dwelling. So today, if you want to follow in your bulletin, let's look at Philippians chapter 3 and see some of the things that are relevant to our going and our getting there. First of all, you'll notice in chapter 3, verse 1, and chapter 4, verse 4, Paul reminds us that to rejoice is a choice. One of the most powerful, unique things God has given us is the power of will to choose. We have willpower, and we can choose. We can choose to be sad or glad. We can choose to be happy or unhappy. We can choose to worship God, or we can choose to wail about the things of the world. But look at chapter 3, verse 1. And he says, "Finally, my brethren, rejoice in the Lord. To write the same things to you, to me indeed, is not grievous. For you, it is safe." Rejoicing has benefits not only to uplift us and to enter into a spirit of worship, but it gives us a sense of safety and security in the Lord. Because when we rejoice, we're with the Lord. And when we're with the Lord, we're safe and we're secure. First of all, notice the source of joy here in chapter 3, verse 1. He said, "Rejoice in the Lord." Rejoice in the Lord, the source of joy. But look at the scope of joy. Turn a page to chapter 4, verse 4, and you will see the scope, the far-reaching scope of joy. Joy is not just an inside job. It is an outside all the way around, up and above, down below, back and forward. And he says in chapter 4, verse 4, "Rejoice in the Lord," what? "Always." There's no time that joy is not available and that we can't rejoice. And again, I say rejoice. This is an emphatic statement with a silent subject, which he means you rejoice. He's given an exhortation with you as the subject. And so it's your privilege and it's your choice to rejoice. But listen carefully to the secret of joy in John 15, 11. Jesus said, "These things I have spoken unto you, that my joy might be in you and that your joy might be full." Did you follow me? Jesus said, "These things," the Word of God. There's joy in the Word of God. There's uplifting messages. There are powerful blessings to strengthen us and to inspire us. And Jesus said, "In these things, I have given you my joy, and I've given you my joy that your joy might be full." One preacher said, "I'm drinking out of the saucer because my cup runneth over." That's joy. That's rejoicing. And the fruit of the Spirit, in Galatians 5, he's given us love and joy and peace. So, first of all, we learn today that rejoicing is a choice. Sometimes when you got a minute, check out Psalm 100, and you will find 7 verbs there that relate to the action of rejoicing. Rejoicing is something we do. It is something of our will that we choose to do. Secondly, here in Philippians chapter 3, there's a word of warning. You know, for every action, there's a reaction. And you know, for every positive, there's a negative. Here, Paul gives us a word of warning in chapter 3, verse 2. and also in verses 18 and 19. And that warning is beware. When God says beware, it means to watch out. The NIV and the New Living Translation says watch out. There are things we should watch for. And he says here in his warning, two watches that we should be very careful to keep. One is dogs. Now, this is not a pet dog. It's not the gentle, docile animal that you love and that's a part of you. We had a little pup, and I loved that little pup, and she loved me. She was precious. I cannot tell you what a blessing to us she was. But what Paul is saying is a reference to the Old Testament, that the dogs in Jerusalem were wild, savage beasts. They were curs. They were diseased. They had mange. They went around scavenging. They were very dangerous. I saw on Facebook this week that a pack of dogs mauled a 13-year-old girl to death. And Paul is using a symbolic comparison of an animal that is nasty and that is just beastly and that is bad to people who are bad in their ways. Dear people, I wish I could tell you, but I have to tell you, not all people in this world are good. And we've seen that, what happened in our own town with the statue of the Ozarks, the Jesus statue, when they put the awful banner on it. Notice, if you will, he says in verse 2, beware of dogs, beware of evil workers, beware of the concision, those who are not baptized, those who are not saved, those who are lost. Notice in verses 18 and 19. For many walk, of whom I have told you often, and now tell you even weeping, that they are the enemies of the cross of Christ, whose end is destruction, whose God is their belly, and whose glory is in their shame, whose mind earthly things. There are people, when you compare them to the holiness of God and the righteousness of the Lord Jesus Christ, they're like those dogs in the Old Testament in Jerusalem. If you notice your outline in the bulletin, you'll notice that he says, beware of dogs. But Peter reminded us in 1 Peter 5:8 to beware of the devil. The devil is behind all the evil in the world. All the wickedness that's happening, all the ungodliness in the world, the devil is behind it. And Peter said, be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, walks about like a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour. So, in our journey, we have to watch for the dangers. We have to watch for the bad people. We have to be on guard that we don't be taken advantage and led astray and fall ourselves into temptation and the wrong way. But notice, chapter 3, verse 3 of Philippians. And there's another word that we're to watch for, a reminder. You can jot it in your bulletin with number C. It's the word worship. He said, beware of two things in relation to worship. He said in verse 3, do worship God. But he said, don't trust yourself. Verse 3, For we are baptized, we're born again, we're the saved children of God, which worship God in spirit and rejoice in Christ Jesus and have no confidence in the flesh. We can't trust ourselves because we have that old fallen nature of Adam within us. But we can trust God. And how do we trust God most? When we worship God in spirit, in obedience to the Lord Jesus Christ. So, verse 3 says, do, but don't. We have to be careful, and we have to be wise, and we have to be warned, first of all, to do the do, but don't do the don't. Sounds simple, doesn't it? But it gets hard sometimes to manage. So, again, number 3, here is a great paradox in the Bible. Losing the lesser, gaining the greatest. We can lose the old life of sin and flesh after Adam, and we can gain the new life in spirit after the Lord Jesus Christ. Read with me verses 7 through 14. They speak for themselves. And Paul is going to tell us 2 things here. He's going to say, count the cost. But he's going to say, compare the blessings. Count the cost of your journey from here to there, on your way looking for a city. But he said, compare what you gain in relation to what you lose. In Philippians chapter 3, verses 7 through 14, let it speak for itself. But what things were gained to me, those I counted loss for Christ. Yea, doubtless I count all things but loss for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things and do count them but as garbage, that I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having my own righteousness, which is of the law, but that which is through faith in Christ, the righteousness which is of God in faith. That I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his suffering, being made conformable unto his death, by any means I might attain unto the resurrection of the dead. There we are. There's the end of our journey. There's the entrance into our new eternal journey. And Paul is simply saying here that sometimes we can lose that which we love the most in order to find him who loves us the most. If you've ever had a loss in your life, Romans 8:28, which is a mystery to me, and a paradox, says God works in all things for good to those who love him, to those who are the called according to his purpose. How can I lose something so precious that I love so much, and God paradoxically works in it for good to bless me and to bring me to be more like him on my journey toward the city that I'm going to live in? Those are mysteries that I don't have all the explanation for, but I believe it. Number 4 in your bulletin, you've never heard me say, get your head on straight and your feet on the ground, have you? I'm going to keep saying it. I'm going to keep saying it until it saturates my being that I have strength to stand and withstand in the Lord in these days and during my journey. If I know where I'm going, and if I have the means and the wherewith to travel in my feet to get there, I'm going to make it. You'll notice in verses 15 and 16, there are two words there that you need to hang on to. Verses 15 and 16, let therefore as many as be perfect be what? Thus minded. As a man thinketh, so is he, the Bible says. And if anything be otherwise minded, God shall reveal even this unto you. Now listen to the next one. Verse 16, nevertheless, whereto we have already attained, let us walk by the same rule, let us mind the same thing. And verse 17, brethren, be followers together of me, and mark them which walk as if you have us for an example. For many walk of whom I have told you often, now tell you again, they're enemies of the cross. Our talk should match our walk, and our walk should match our talk. And that's what Paul is saying here. He's saying, in your journey, know what you believe. Let me ask you a pointed question. If somebody asked you, what do you believe, could you tell them what you believe? On the back of your bulletin, there is my statement of what I believe, because I worked it out to the point that if anybody asked me what I believe, this is what I could tell them. And if you can need this to take it for yourself, write your name on it and put your amen on it. And if anybody asks you, say, this is what I believe. I believe in the ultimate end of all endings, there is a new beginning, though unseen at the time. I believe God is faithful to his word and that he fulfills his promises for those who trust in him. I believe every prayer has an answer in some way as to prove God's work in all things for good to those who love him. I believe the future is greater than the past to bring in the present, again, all that was lost yesterday. I believe this too shall come to pass. Then beyond today, tomorrow will come, and with it new hope. I believe I am somebody worth with a purpose in life to make a difference in this world for the glory of God and for the good of all mankind. I believe in Jesus Christ, Lord, Savior, Son of God, resurrected from the dead and coming again. I rest my heart in him to be my help in time of need. I place my faith in him and give myself to be with him in glory. I believe in heaven, the perfect place of purity and peace, where as a joint heir in Christ, I will know as I am known, fulfilled, satisfied, and complete. I know whom I have believed, and I'm persuaded that he's able to keep that which I've committed unto him against that day. Blessed are they that have not seen yet have believed. Know what you believe. Get your head on straight and your feet on the ground, so that you can stand and withstand. Lastly, in Philippians chapter 3, we need to know where we're going and how to get there. Look at verses 20 and 21. He says two things about our destination. Here's the end of our journey in chapter 3. Verses 20 and 21, for our conversation, our life. Conversation is our lifestyle. It's our living. Is in heaven For whence also we look for the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall change our vile bodies, that it may be fashioned like unto his glorious body, according to the working whereby he is able even to subdue all things unto himself. The key word, heaven. That's home. You've heard home is where the heart is. But I say heaven is where the heart is at home. And when we get there, we're going to say, I'm home. Praise God. I've made it. I'm at home. And then that other word here is the word changed. He says we're going to be changed from the way we are in the world physically to the world that's going to come spiritually. 1 Corinthians 15, we shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. And we're going to make a transition to a transformation. When we make that transition out of the world to heaven, we're going to make a transformation to be from the way we are humanly to be like Jesus. Because now we've found the city. We've found the city where we're home. And I'll tell you this, it's so simple. He is coming down and we're going up. Aren't you looking forward to the trip? He's coming down and we're going up. Paul said that Jesus would descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of an archangel, with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. And we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with him in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. Are you looking for a city? I'm looking for a city. I'm rounding third and heading home. And I'm not going to slide in. I'm going in, standing up. And when I get there, I'm going to say, the Lord Jesus Christ, here I come. Let's stand together.
Would you turn to 295? And we're going to sing all the verses of Near to the Heart of God. Sin cannot
Together while we eat.